Good evening, everybody. I'm Barry Fear. Welcome to Friday, November 12th. This is the daily edition of the Daily Wraps and the evening edition. Today I have created a new intro and an outro for the show. Before I present the new intro and outro, I'd like to put on this video the original intro and outro to the show. I hope you enjoy the current intro and outro and the new intro and outro to the Daily Wrap. And this is episode 303. I hope you enjoyed this episode 303. I'm sorry I have not been able to put episode 302 up. Okay, so I'm sorry about that. But anyway, enough of me jibber-jabbering about the episode. Let's get this episode up and running so you viewers can check out the new intro and outro. So here it is. Enjoy it, and I will see you at the end of the show. Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to yet another edition of the Daily Wraps. Barry Fear and Alec Taylor in the studio with you this morning, and what a glorious Friday morning we've got here. So our opening advice is please take it easy on the roads, as there were two accidents on Warringah Road yesterday. So drivers out there, please take care. It rhymes. So here's Alec now. Good morning to you.
Morning, Barry. Thanks for having me on the show. Yep. Appreciate it.
So we've got a groovy intro and outro for our show now. A shot of me at Manly Beach and the chopper. And you will love it, guys. Here's Alec now for his opening sequence on this.
Yeah, thanks, Barry. So, yeah, we've got a new intro and outro for your show. You come up with an awesome concept of using the old intro and outro from a TV show. So, do you want to tell the viewers about what it is, what the background is?
Well, it is called, excuse me. Well, it is called Chopper Squad, guys. So, Chopper Squad, like we said before, it was filmed in the 70s at DY Beach. And it was produced by the Grundy Organization Production. So we changed the name to Cerebral Palsy Alliance Production. So pretty good, eh? You'll be impressed by the intro and outro when you see it. So this morning on the show, we're going to be talking about safety on the beach and surf life saving. Now, safety on the beach, let's open with that. This is important because with summer around the corner, guys, you want to be prepared for the beach now. Rule number one, be prepared for the beach. Head out.
Yeah, that's right, Barry. So first thing you need to think about if you're heading to the beach is what you need to do before you get there. So what do you bring to the beach, and what do you think about before you get there? All sorts of things to think about, including even, I suppose, where to go. So some beaches are better than others in certain weather conditions. So lots to think about in terms of being prepared. What else is there?
Okay, rule number two, listen to the radio and television reports. Find out where there are beach closes and when they are. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So sometimes your favorite beach is actually closed for a variety of reasons. There could have been like a shark sighting, or you know, maybe blue bottles, or it could just be dangerous surf. And so sometimes the beach will be closed. So yeah, definitely listen to radio reports, or maybe get online, look up the surf conditions, and you can usually find out if a beach has been closed.
So don't be an absolute nincompoop and think that it's going to be safe, or assume that it's going to be safe, because another important factor, guys, is if there are huge swells or dangerous currents or rips, make alternate plans. Do not go to the beach when I'm doing this. It means forget about it. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So if there are dangerous conditions and they've closed the beach, don't even go. Don't be one of those people that goes in the water anyway. It's just not safe and it's not worth it. Too many people every year get into trouble at the beach by not following the rules. And swimming between the flags where, you know, it's safe, and where the surf lifesavers have figured out it's actually safe for you to swim. So yeah, don't be one of those people that swims where it is not safe or at a closed beach.
So don't be an absolute plonker and put your life at risk and other people's lives.
Yeah, that's right, because there is some real danger, isn't there, at the beach. So if you do swim at a dangerous beach that isn't being patrolled and that has been closed, you absolutely put your life at risk. You could get into real trouble, and in fact I think there might have been a drowning last week or something. I'm not sure if that was somebody at a closed beach or not, but you do hear about people getting into trouble and either needing to be rescued or even dying at dangerous beaches.
Now, we've got another golden rule that Alec and I would like to bring up on the show this morning is safety and your valuables. Now, do not leave your valuables lying anywhere around the beach, even on the beach or tables, or even on the bench in the change room, because someone can come along and go, here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So lots of theft happens at the beach. You don't want to have any valuable stuff. And I think this goes back to your first point around being prepared. And one of the things that you can prepare, one of the ways you can prepare is to not take too many valuables, to try not to take any valuables if you can. But if you do have some, yeah, don't leave them on the bench in the change rooms, or don't leave them in a really obvious place on the beach. Make sure that they're hidden and safe and secure.
Because if you leave valuables lying around, like your cash, someone could again go, here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. Someone could come along and swipe them. And just from under your nose, they could take your valuable things. I don't know, maybe your wallet or your purse, or perhaps a really nice phone, or any phone really, I suppose. Could happen so quickly, just someone walking past and just swipe them off your towel.
And then they go.
Yeah, exactly. Yep, they swipe them off and steal them, and that's it. They're gone, you know. So yes, you need to be very careful about your personal valuables. Make sure you try not to take as many as you can. Try not to take any if possible. But if you do have some, make sure they're safe and secure so people can't swipe them.
And don't carry large amounts of cash or leave it lying around. Because once again, I'm going to do this. And your money's gone. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. And cash is particularly risky, isn't it? Because at least with something like a credit card, you can stop it. And with a phone, you can usually lock it. But with cash, that's it. It's gone. And anybody can just take the cash and use it any way they like. So that's probably one of the really big things to avoid taking to the beach, is any cash at all. Don't take a lot of cash.
Okay. Now, another important factor when you park your car at the beach, take the keys out of the ignition, okay, and then lock it. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So very, very common for people to get into cars and take things from out of cars. And it's also quite common for people to leave cash or other valuables inside their car and to think that they're safe. But they're only safe if you take those keys with you and make sure that the car is locked.
And put a steering lock on two guys. Here's my operator.
Yeah, a steering lock, particularly if you have an old car. I think some of the newer cars, they have immobilizers so that if you've got the key, people can't actually steal it. So I think steering locks are really good for cars that were made before immobilizers. So any car that's like 10 years or older or more, of which there are a lot of cars on the road like that now, you definitely want to make sure that it can't be driven away. Maybe put a steering lock on or some other device to stop people from stealing.
So just getting back to the cash, don't tell anyone how much cash you've got or show it, because there could be $500 there and somebody may come along and again, here's Alan now.
Yeah, that's right. So you might be at the beach, maybe you go to the shop to buy something like an ice cream or some lunch food or whatever, and you pull out your wallet and you flash the cash. Maybe there's lots and lots of cash in there, and the person behind you or in front of you or just anybody nearby actually sees that cash, then they'll know that you've got it, and they'll try and target you. Maybe they'll watch you until you go in for a swim or something and then swipe your wallet. So yeah, be careful about how you handle your cash and who you show it to, and yeah, as you say, who you tell about it as well. So you don't want to kind of openly say, oh, I've got hundreds of dollars of cash in my wallet, because anybody could hear you and then target you.
So now it's time to talk about arranging a meeting point at the beach. Well, now on the second part of the beach segment here on the show. Okay, arranging a meeting point, because if you're going to the beaches in large groups, guys, and beach goers out there, arrange a meeting point. Here's Alec now for this.
Yeah, so if you're meeting lots of people, you all want to be able to find each other at the beach. And the beaches are big places, you know. So, and also, you usually, if you're driving to a beach, you may have to park far away. And it might be hard to find all of the other people that you're going to go with. So, yeah, it's a very good idea to have a specific meeting place at the beach.
So, okay. When Georgia and I and Alec went to Manly Beach earlier this year, we didn't park our van too far away. Here's Alec.
Yeah, we actually got a great park. It was Georgia who found the park. We were sort of driving around and she just spied this fantastic park down near the walkway. On the harbour side, which also had plenty of room behind it as well, which was good. And we were right there, weren't we? We were able to just go straight onto the boardwalk and go down to the beach, the harbourside beach in the wharf. And then we went for a trip around or a walk around Manly, which was good fun.
So you may have seen, you know, in our old intro, me smiling away with my glasses and having this. It was a great day, so it was really a fun day. So make sure you don't park too far away in case someone gets sick or you need to go home and you go run. Someone needs to go to the M or else. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. You want to try and park as close as you can to the beach just in case someone does need to leave in a hurry. Of course, it's really hard and some beaches have really terrible parking. And I'm just thinking about, I think it's Bilgola Beach is one of those beaches where it's got a tiny little car park and it's nowhere near big enough and it's only accessible by car. And it's nowhere near big enough and people park all around it and for miles and miles around. And yeah, if you get sick or somebody needs to go in a hurry, you're kind of in trouble. Someone has to run to go get the car and maybe drive it back or maybe all of you try and go get the car, but you want to be as close as possible to the beach if you can be.
And if you need to be close to the men's room or ladies' room there, someone could be really sick. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So you may, if someone is sick, you may want to be able to go to the men's room or the bathrooms. And the other thing, I guess, is that a lot of beaches have surf lifesaving clubs on them. And there are quite often people who can help you as well. And they've usually been trained in, you know, first aid and they usually have seen a lot of people that need help at the beach. So that's another place that you can go as well, I guess, if you're in trouble, you need some help at the beach.
So, okay, getting back to our meeting point. Okay, if you choose to go off in a small group, arrange a meeting point, okay? Say, for example, the Manly Surf Lifesaving Club, which is where we did our final scene. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So on that trip earlier in the year with Georgia, we walked along the boardwalk on the harbour side and then along the concourse, which was really cool. And Barry, you pointed out a lot of interesting sites, local sites and buildings and things like that. And then we made it to the other side and kind of did some more filming over there and walked along the beach all the way down to the Surf Lifesaving Club. And that's where we filmed the final scene.
So, So a range of meeting point, guys, okay? Because you, seriously, you are responsible for your own actions. Have a mobile phone with you in case something does happen and you do get sick. Here's Alex now.
Yeah, that's right. It's a really good idea to have a phone with you, just in case you do need to call someone or call for help. And yeah, a specific meeting place is good too. You can't just say, oh, let's meet at the beach. You actually sort of need to say, you know, whereabouts at the beach. Otherwise, and you know, in the middle of summer, there could be thousands and thousands of people at the beach that you're going to. So you need to say a specific place that you will meet, not just, oh, let's meet at the beach. Something like, yep, we'll meet outside the Surf Life Saving Club, or...
And arrange a time, because say like 12 midday, here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So you could end up going at completely different times if you're not quite specific about, oh, let's meet around midday at a certain place. And if you don't do that, it's quite likely that you'll miss your friends and you won't be able to see them and hang out with them.
So don't just go, I'll see you later, because the person may look around and they think, oh, where's this person gone? Or that person? Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So make sure you tell people where you're going to meet, and then when you're going. Say, okay, I'm heading off now. It's been cool. It's been fun. So you want to make sure that people know what you're doing, and where you're going to meet, and at what time you're going to meet.
And make sure before you depart the beach, make sure you tell the person to be back at the car at a certain time. Here's my off-sider.
Yeah, so are you talking about when you leave the beach?
When you leave the beach.
Yeah, so when you leave the beach, and maybe you've split up through the day, maybe someone's gone for a swim and another person hasn't, they've gone to the bathroom to change, and you've got a plan to meet up at the car. We're going to meet up at the car at 4 o'clock and then we'll go home, so that you don't have one of you sort of sitting there for a whole lot of time waiting for somebody else who didn't quite know when you were going to meet up. So yeah, have a specific time for when you're going to meet up to leave and go home.
And sometimes people don't do that. So don't just say you're going to meet at the car or van at 4 o'clock, and then the person's waiting and waiting for you because they could be worried sick. Here's my off-sider.
Yeah, that's right. So if you make a plan, make sure you follow through and you keep the arrangement. Because you don't want to worry someone about you. You try to keep track of the time, make sure that you're not late, so that they don't get worried about where, you know, if something has happened to you. Because there are some risks at the beach, and it is easy to worry that someone's been hurt. So it's a very good idea to know where you're going to meet up and when, and then to keep that arrangement, you know?
Okay, because like the person could be sitting in the car for 20 minutes and then getting anxious. Here's my off-sider.
Yeah, that's right. So you know that when you're waiting for someone and they're late, you do start to worry, don't you? You think, has something happened to them? You know, they said they would meet me at a certain time. They're not here. Time is going past. Maybe they've just forgotten, or maybe they've been delayed for some trivial reason, but maybe something bad has happened. Maybe, you know, they're in trouble or hurt or something. And so it's very natural, I think, for people who are waiting, particularly after a while, for people who are waiting to start to think maybe something's gone wrong, maybe they're in trouble.
So ring the person and find out where they have got to, because this is important. Here's my offline.
Yeah, that's right. So if you are in that situation and you're waiting for someone who does take a long time, if you've both got your phone, absolutely give them a call or send them a message and say, you know, just wondering if you're okay. You know, I thought we were going to meet at such and such time. Where are you? Are you on the way? And maybe most likely they'll be just, you know, delayed, or they will have forgotten or lost track of time. And most likely they won't have been hurt. But it's probably the easiest way of finding out, isn't it? And it's like a reminder to
me. Could I just say, correct you?
Yeah.
They might not have been hurt.
Yeah. Oh, what did I say? Yes. So most likely they haven't been hurt. They probably haven't been hurt, but they could have, I suppose. And it's a good way of checking with the phone or with a message, with a call or a message, to make sure that they haven't been hurt and that they're on the way to the car.
Okay, so have fun at the beach, guys, but be really careful and specific. And just going over the basic rules one more time. Okay, make sure you've got everything prepared, like your sun cream, your beach umbrella, your beach chair, okay, and things like that, and your picnic basket. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So make sure you've got your towel, if you're taking a towel, your sunscreen, so that you're not going to get burnt by the sun. Yeah, a picnic basket with some food, maybe some lunch or a snack, an apple or a banana or something like that is good at the beach. Yeah, so make sure that you're prepared and you've got everything you need for when you're at the beach.
And before you go to the beach, a family discussion about the outing, because the weather might be shonky on the day and you may have to make alternative arrangements. Here's my offline.
Yeah, that's right. So if you're going with your family, have a chat beforehand and talk to them about, you know, how to have a good, safe and fun time at the beach. And if you have kids, you know, talk to them about what to do if they get separated. You know, go and talk to a lifesaver or a police person if there is one around.
Or a police officer, we call them.
Police officer, exactly. Or a police officer. So, yeah, have that conversation with the family, maybe on the way to the beach in the car or before you leave. So you make sure you've all got the same understanding of what you're going to do, and you can enjoy the day, but enjoy it safely.
And like I've said, take life valuable, to someone again could go and wacko you're valuable, they're gone. Here's my offsider.
Yeah, that's right. So you want to make sure you don't take anything too valuable. Certainly no large amounts of cash, as you said. You definitely don't want to take that. And leave as many valuables at home as you can. Maybe take your phone, because that is a safety device and it is a way of getting in contact with other people. But even with that, try and keep it in a safe place. Try and put it away in a bag if you're going to leave it somewhere, and just try to make sure that it's secure and safe and not visible for someone to steal.
Okay, because stealing is a crime, guys. So if you see any suspicious activity on the beach, call police. And another golden rule before we head to the break is no violence on the beach. Because if you had too much alcohol the previous day, don't go bang, 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 and use your fist as your punching bag and into somebody else. And another thing, there may be alcohol-free zones too at some certain beaches. Here's my offside.
Yeah, that's right. So if you do have too much to drink, or even if you're just too rowdy, you could be asked to leave. Or if you do hurt somebody or hit somebody, you could be arrested. So yeah, absolutely make sure that you have a good time in a safe way, a way that's good for everybody else, so that everyone at the beach can have a good time.
And make sure, guys, that you compromise who's going to do what at the beach. Who's going to go for their swim first, second, third, or last? It depends how many members of the family you have got, etc. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So plan things out and make sure that you're all organized and you know where people are at different times. Because it is easy to, I mean, it's okay to go in different directions, and somebody's going to go over here to play and someone's maybe going to go for a swim or something. But make sure you know where people are going so that you can find them again if you need to.
So don't just say, see you later. See you later and not know where the person's gone, because they could be lost or some stranger has kidnapped them. Here's my offside.
Yeah, that's right. So you want to know where people are going. You don't just say, I'm going, or see you later, or whatever. You actually say, okay, I'm going to go over to the bathroom, and I'll be back in a few minutes, or I'm going to go for a swim and I'll be back in 20 minutes, or I'm going to go to the shop. And so if you're clear about where you've gone and about how long you'll be, then people will know where you are and what you're doing, and then they'll know about how long you'll take and they won't have to worry about you.
And set your alarm on your mobile phone, so that way you've reminded yourself. Put a reminder on your phone, okay? Because most mobile phones these days, guys, they do have an alarm, or write a reminder. Say, for example, meet back at Van at 11:30. Here's my offline.
Yeah, that's right, because it's actually really easy to forget. So you might have like a really quick conversation with someone. Oh, we're going to meet at the car at 4. Okay. And then you separate, and then an hour later you go, what time did we say again? And you've already forgotten. So it's a good idea to maybe put a reminder on your phone or an alarm that says, you know, 4 o'clock, that's the time we're going to meet. So yeah, it's good to actually make a record of your arrangement so that you can keep it and remember it. Very easy to forget something like that.
Well, our last topic on the beach, okay, is knowing your CPR. How to do CPR if someone is unconscious on the beach, okay? Pick up a resuscitation shaft. That word is a tongue twister.
Yeah.
So, pick up a resuscitation shaft and go over it with your family, or even pick up 2 copies so you've got one for the car and one for your home. Here's Alex.
Yeah, that's right. So it's a good idea for everybody to have an understanding of CPR, and it's good, and there are some really good sort of brochures and flyers and things out there that you can download and talk about as a family or with your friends who are going to the beach. And then there's, of course, there's the good old rule, Dr. ABC, danger, response, airway, breathing, CPR. So there are a few things that you should check before you start CPR. So if a person's already breathing, you don't need to do CPR, but if they are not, that's when you need to do CPR. And it's a good idea to know how to do CPR.
So, if you need to call for an ambulance, okay, on 000, okay, tell the ambulance service where you are, what beach you are, at the adjacent suburb at the beach, okay, and the exact location at the beach. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So you want them to be able to find you as fast as they possibly can. So the more specific you are about where you are, the faster it is that they'll get to you. So you want to tell them which beach you're at and whereabouts on the beach you are, so they can come straight to you as fast as they can.
Okay, and have your mobile phone switched on so that the ambulance service can call you back to obtain further information from you. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So if you call them and then stop talking to them, make sure that your phone is on and available and within reach so that you can talk to them again if they can't find you and they need to call you. Although they may even just leave the call going, so it's possible they'll just leave it connected with you. You may not be able to keep talking to someone. So if you aren't talking to the Triple Zero people anymore, make sure your phone is available. It's right there, and you can get to it if they need to call you.
So it's very important, guys, because when you call an ambulance, assure the person that help is on its way. And if you've got someone that's already with you, with the platinum unconscious person, please make your phone call and come straight back. Here's my operator.
Yeah, that's right. So you've got to stay with someone if they need help. You make your phone call, but you keep maybe doing CPR if that's what you're doing, or just looking after them and making sure they're okay. You want to stay close to them if somebody's in trouble or hurt.
So what would you do, Alec, if we were out and I needed an ambulance?
Well, of course, I would call one straight away. So I always have my phone with me. I would call 000 if I thought you needed an ambulance. And I would talk to them and I would tell them where we were. And then we would stay put at the location that I said we were at. And then I would make sure that you were okay. I would do everything that I could to make sure you were okay while we waited for the ambulance to arrive.
So if I was sick, say while we were out, say like Manly, but if I was struggling to breathe, and couldn't breathe and was coughing, what would you do?
Well, we would try and help you. So maybe we would, I'm not sure exactly. I think it would depend on the specific circumstances, but we would try and get you into a place where there was good fresh air, and we would try and make sure there was nothing caught in your throat. Do you want to pause?
So if we want to, so like if Alec was calling an ambulance for me and she had another Opsider with him, what would he do? Here's my Opsider.
Yeah, that's right. So if the other Opsider was there, they would make sure that you were okay, that there was no obstruction in your throat. Maybe they would perform CPR if you did stop breathing. But if you were still breathing, they would just make sure you were a good temperature, you weren't too hot or too cold, and that you were comfortable and had good oxygen. And then we would wait together in a safe place for the ambulance to come.
So we hope that you've enjoyed our segment on the beach today. And remember, another important point is when you're watching the weather report, guys, is the temperature. How hot is it going to be? Here's my Opsider.
Yeah, that's right. Because if it's going to be a really hot, dry day, you're going to want to take some water with you and make sure you stay hydrated. That's another safety thing. So yeah, make sure you understand what the temperature is going to be on the day before you go there.
So we hope that you've enjoyed the segment on the show. Now here is our closing segment. Our last topic today is about pool safety at home and things like that. Now, safety around swimming pools at the beach and at home. Let's talk about the beach. Okay, don't ever leave your child unattended because they could slip on a wet rock and go splash. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. You don't want to leave your kids unattended at the beach because they could wander off, slip on a rock, they could go down to the water. You absolutely want to supervise your kids at the beach at all times.
And at home as well, because if you've got a backyard pool and it hasn't got a lockable gate, your 3-year-old or 2-year-old can go wandering off, and again, you might not know where they are. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So you have to be really careful around pools at home. Make sure that your kids definitely don't have access to it. Make sure that the fences are all legally compliant and perfectly safe. And then when you do go for a swim, make sure you stay there and watch them at all times. It can happen, bad things can happen really, really quickly in a backyard pool. So yes, you have to be super vigilant and very careful.
So don't just think, oh my God, 20 minutes later, the kids running, gone to the pool. Then you have to take off your shoes and socks and dive in after them. Here's Alan now.
Yeah, that's right. So if you do end up with one of your kids in the pool and they can't swim, you have to go in after them. You probably don't even take your shoes and socks off. You probably just jump straight in whatever clothes you happen to be in to pull them out, because you know it's a race that you've got to save them and make sure that they're okay. So that's why you keep an eye on them, and you don't let yourself get into that situation where you've got a child in the pool that needs rescuing. You want to avoid that situation at all costs.
So we do hope that you've enjoyed our show today and learned a lot from Alec and I today, and we do, and this fits in with our groovy tune that we've got, and here is the recap on that.
Yeah, that's right. So new intro and outro today, very, very groovy music. We hope that the viewers love the new intro and outro on your Daily Raps videos.
So this has been episode 303 today. Thank you for your company on our daily edition of the Daily Wraps and the number that we rely on 24 hours a day, that is 000. Please do not be a plonker with that number and tell me tell the ambulance service something that hasn't happened, or the police or fire brigade, because school holidays not too far off, there will be a spike in prank 000 calls. So mums and dads, teach your kids the meaning of right and wrong when calling 000. Here's my outsider for his closing sequence on this.
Yeah, thanks, Barry. Thanks for having me on the show. And yeah, as you say, 000 for emergencies only. And parents, you know, make sure you monitor your kids and teach them not to use it and not to make prank calls to 000.
Because you could be putting someone like me or Alec at risk. Here's Alec now.
Yeah, that's right. So it's just for people who really need it. If 000 gets lots of prank calls, then they won't be able to service the real calls where people actually really genuinely need help.
And like myself, I can't drive to the hospital. Here's Alan now.
Yeah, that's right. So we would absolutely need to make sure that we could get you to the hospital safely. And that's why we need all the time we can. We can't afford for our emergency services to be distracted by nuisance calls or prank calls or anything like that.
So on that note, it is time for us to draw episode 303 to a close, and you'll have a great weekend, and we'll see you next Friday morning, and we will go through all this again. Join Alec and I then. We do hope that you will have a lovely weekend. And like we say, take care on the roads, guys, because the roads can be slippery. And next week we'll be talking about safety on the roads and in floodwaters. So join us for another jam-packed episode. On behalf of all of us here at the Daily Wraps now, a very good morning to you, and have an excellent weekend. Here's Alec now for his farewell.
Thanks for having me on the show, Barry, and have a great weekend.
And we'll see you again on Friday morning, same time, same place. You know when we bring the show to you. So until then, bye-bye, and have a safe day at the beach and on the water. Bye-bye, and thanks for watching. Bye-bye. I hope that you've enjoyed today's show. Today, to take us out, I'd like to introduce you to the outro to the show, the new outro, and then I will put the old intro and the outro in. So I hope you all have a great weekend, and I will talk to you next week. Have a great weekend, everyone. Bye-bye.